I'm gonna take us live.
It's serious.
And we are here. We're live in outer space with Hollis Stacy, straight from Colorado, outer space. Welcome, Hollis.
Nice to be here. Thank you for having me.
I'm so happy to have you today. It's gonna be so much fun. How's life in Colorado?
Well, Colorado is probably 80% less humidity than where you are right now. And,
yes,
you know, we're doing well with the COVID, you know, we're not spiking like Florida is. So, you know, everybody out here is pretty much wearing masks. So
yeah, that's good. You're compliant as you are.
Yes.
So I have to, before we get started, I have to brag a little bit about you because that's what I like to do before we get started. And first and foremost, Hall of Famer, Hollis Stacy, winner of 18 LPGA events, 4 major championships, and I think like 22,000 US amateurs. I'm not quite sure if that's the exact number, but or if you're that old, but Hollis won 3 consecutive US girls amateur championships, which done consecutive like that is a pretty darn good feat. So I'm so happy to have you here. And I'm so happy to talk about, we're gonna talk a little bit about golf. We're gonna talk a little bit about you and a little bit about life on tour and, you know, those kind of things. So just to get started. So, you know, unfortunately or fortunately, Beth Ann Nichols did a very, very good interview with you in Golf Week last week. And so Beth Ann, you stole a lot of my questions, but that's okay because not everybody here today has necessarily read that article. But one thing I want to talk about, and I think anytime you talk to Hollis Stacy, you have to talk about your family, Hollis. So you came from an extraordinarily large golfing family. So can you kind of fill us in on that and what it was like to be a kid in that family and where you are in the standings?
Well, I'm one of 10 children. And Jack and Tilly had us in a span of 16 years. So, you know, we had a lot of fun. My dad was just full of life. Great athlete, went to Clemson, played football. And, wow. But his biggest competitor, he landed with General Patton and faced the Panzer division. He landed with Patton and was shot like December 11th, 44, right before the Battle of the Bulge. So he saw some really bad stuff. But you know, he was on his belly for 2 miles, you know, shooting and doing all that stuff. But I think that's where, you know, he came back and in a body cast, but he came back and he had such a love for life and decided and married Tilly and had 10 of us and decided that he was going to have, you know, so much fun with his kids and we were going to be raised with golf or whatever we wanted to do. And we did, you know, we grew up in front of that black and white TV set, you know, must have seen that poor guy, you know, when he fell off the skis, you know, the exhilaration of victory and the agony of defeat. We must have seen that 5,000 times. And we were just amazed every time it happened. But we just had so much fun, you know, growing up and playing golf. And, you know, we did hate playing golf with my father because he loved giving us lessons. And we'd always get mad and storm off and, you know, the usual kid stuff when you're immature. Yes. And now I wish I could be playing golf with my dad, but I can't.
Yeah, so. No kidding, right?
I know.
But you came from a phenomenal golf family. You know, Martha still plays great golf and your siblings played. I mean, with 10, you had more than a couple foursomes going in your family. Right. Were your mom and dad golfers? I mean, we're going to talk about Tilly in a minute because Tilly's a whole nother subject. But were your mom and dad golfers? Is that how you guys got into it?
Well, my dad was a phenomenal athlete. I mean, you know, he was in 3 sports in college and, you know, my mom didn't play golf, but she could jitterbug. She could jitterbug. She could dance. Let me just straighten that out. And she could play golf, but one time I played with her when I came back from tour, and I said, come on, Mom, let's go play golf. Well, she decided to swing like me. Oh. And so, you know how we swing. We like to swing from our toes. And so she decided to swing from her toes, and she couldn't get out of bed the next day.
Oh, no.
Said, oh, honey, I ripped all my muscles off. But she used to shoot in the mid-80s, so she knew a lot about golf. But she was on the USGA, as you know.
I know. Well, I was going to talk about that, because what people don't necessarily know is that on an LPGA events, we have the same set of rules officials that travel with us every week. And there's one time in the year, or sometimes two at the British Open, but certainly one at the US Open back in the day, where the USGA Women's Committee were the officials, the rules officials for the week, including a couple of our officials, but mostly they were the rules officials.
Right.
And I played in quite a few US Opens, as you did as well. And whether Tilly was your mom or not, Tilly was on the US Women, on the Women's Committee.
Oh, yeah.
And she was strict. If Tilly was in that scoring tent, when you went in to give your card, certainly for me, I was always scared. It's like, there's Tilly. Tilly's serious. But she was on the Women's Committee for years, Hollis. How many years did she serve on that?
She was on the committee for about 10.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. She has some great stories. Now, have you heard the Jan Stevenson story?
No, please tell us. Yeah.
So Jan, I said, now, Mom, you really have to know the rules. You really do. I mean, you know, so I was horrible. So there Jan is leading the tournament. You know, she's in Oklahoma. And she's leading that tournament.
She won, right?
Yeah. And she hits it left. And she's in, she's somewhere where, you know, she would like a drop. Jan, and we tell the story all the time, and Jan is stressing out. She goes, oh God, here comes an official. And then she sees it's my mom.
It's
and she goes, oh, it's Hollis' mother. Oh God. And so I had told my mom, you know, really, I want you to know the rules. Anyway, so Jan says, you know, my mom approaches Jan. And then my mother says, Jan, what would you do? And so Jan, well, I would come over here and I would put a tee and I would go one club length, then I would drop it. That's fine with me. So
hopefully it was the right thing to do.
Oh, it was. Did you know that my mom was instrumental in bringing Suzanne Jackson into golf?
No.
Suzanne was like the only other girl golfer in the state of Georgia in the 1670s. And so the U.S. Juniors was in 69, was in Brookhaven, Texas. So I had met Suzanne in that spring of 69 playing in the state amateur. And so my mom called up Frank and Glow, her parents, and you know, they weren't going to let her go play. And so my mom begged her parents, Frank and Glow. And so she made it to the semifinals.
Oh my gosh,
that's awesome. Juniors. And so that was her push into national golf. And then, as you know, she played the mini tour with the LPGA, and then she was rules official, and then she became our LPGA official.
Yes, one of our very, very, very
good. We love Suzanne Jackson. I still remember her address, 729 Ridgecrest, LaGrange.
Oh my gosh, Hollis.
Before the zip code.
In Georgia. Oh my gosh, Hollis.
I know.
Susie was a dear friend of all of ours, and unfortunately passed way, 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 way too young from breast cancer. So, but she was a very, very dear friend of all of ours.
Yeah.
And one of the funniest people I think I ever knew in my entire life. But
she could make you laugh.
Yes, she could. Well, speaking of funny and golf, one of my really funny stories that I can tell now that I'm out of competition has to do with your sister. obviously.
Oh, please tell that story. Yeah.
And it's better maybe if you tell it from when you, if you know the story of me and Gene, right? We were qualifying for, I think it might've been a US Open qualifier.
It was in Atlanta.
Is that right? When obviously, I ran out of golf balls.
Yeah, obviously, and they were all my used golf balls.
They were. So we get on the 18th hole in Atlanta and we're playing in this open qualifying, playing with Gene. And I'm having a horrible day. I'm gonna miss the qualifier anyway. And Jean is, she was so sweet to play with and so nice. And we were chatting all day and we get on the 18th tee and I hit a ball into the water off the tee and I'm done. I mean, I'm not gonna make it anyway, but I am now out of golf balls. So, I'm pretty sure Jean wasn't going to make it either. And I kind of looked at her totally embarrassed and said, and I think at that time, I don't even think I was a pro. And I looked at her and I said, I don't have any more golf balls.
And you know, I know what Jean said. She said, bent down, unzipped it. She goes, don't worry about it.
Totally against the rules. I mean, you can't share golf balls, right? And obviously they were all your used ones. And she said, here, take one of mine. And she got one out of her bag and gave it to me. And I finished the hole. Totally illegal. But like I said, I wasn't going to make it anyway. But it was so cute. She was so cute. Just, don't worry about it. Take one of mine. So anyway.
She's cute.
I know. That's one of my favorite. I think about that. I can literally visualize ourselves on that tee and me being completely panicked. So you have to tell Jean.
You can share equipment now. Right.
What's that?
You can share equipment now. Golf balls.
Yeah. Even golf balls? Really?
I think so. I think you can.
Back then you couldn't. So it was totally illegal. So, all right, Hollis. So let's talk a little bit about the tour. Back in the day, you know, when I was talking to Jan here a couple weeks ago, and I feel like you're in this group as well. You know, I feel like my era, which came a little bit after you, just a little bit, but enough that I feel like you guys, you and Jan and Judy Rankin and Donna Capone and Laura Baugh and like this whole group that was sort of like there were the founders and then there were the like soldiers. And you guys were the group that kind of took the reins from the founders, you know, got us on TV, got us playing for more money. Really, you guys did so much work then that, when you look at the history of the tour, you don't know that unless you kind of know the stories behind it. And I talked to Jan a little bit about that. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about that, about your experiences during that time and the things that you did that maybe people don't know about, that, the extra things that you guys had to do besides just going out there and playing golf and playing some pro-ams.
Well, there were some tournaments that were, you know, begging the players, the top players to play in. And we had 33, 34 events domestically. Uh-huh. And so, you know, I remember playing in most of them. So, and there were some that I didn't want to play in, but you know, it was, you know, we had that quota. We had to have X amount of the top 10, X amount out of the top 15. And, you know, the sponsors were putting, you know, the LPGA speak to the fire, you know, like,
right.
You know, they always threatened. And so I can remember, you know, playing in tournaments I really didn't want to play in and, you know, being exhausted at the end of the year.
Right.
So, you know, we always went to the pro-am parties, you know, and we actually made fun out of them, you know.
Right.
You know, we knew what the Kathy Whitworths, the Mickey Wrights, the Mary Mills, and, you know, the Betsy Rawls, you know, we know what they did. You know, they drove.
Right.
They set up their golf courses. Oh, the Peggy Kirkbells. They drove and they hammered the stakes. So we know what they did. We know what Carol Mann did. You know, she, and so, you know, we love them. And I know Jan did a heck of a lot. with Reggie. She did. Behind the scenes.
She told some great stories. She told some amazing stories. I had no idea. You know, I mean, there was so much work that went on behind the scenes that people don't know about, you know, and they don't appreciate, like, you know, fans that are watching and they see the people that are playing well every week, right? And especially when we first started getting on TV and you started knowing you guys who were always on TV and playing well every week. And there are so many players behind the scenes you talk about, like Mary Mills and that, you know, or do so much. They do a lot of the legwork, and Jan was a top player, but she was also doing the legwork. But that's what made the tour what it was today. You know,
it was a great sisterhood.
Yes. Everybody right. was, you know, you were all in it together, and we all were. And then, you know, when I came on tour and the era of players that kind of, you know, Patty Sheehan and then kind of the next group after that. You know, it's the unwritten rule, right? You go to the pro-am parties, like you said, you play in the pro-ams, you play in the tournaments when they ask you to play, right? Because that's just what you do.
Yeah. I like the pro-ams because I used it as a practice round. And if I had someone that was misbehaving, I always had the other people take care of them. You know, I didn't let it bother me. You know, we've had those, but very rare.
No. And we knew, you know, I talked about this with everybody, but we knew that Wednesday was our most important day, right, of the week. I mean, you know, you're playing there for your purse, but the most important day is to make sure that the sponsors have, you know, a great experience, you know. And so that's what I love to talk about, the Legends Tour, when people say, well, what's so special about the Legends Tour? And I say, not that the players today do not appreciate pro-ams, because they do, but I think that our era of players, there was just something very, there was an urgency in doing and right, you know? And I think that we all still feel that way now when we play.
Right. I mean, it's important that you make sure the pro-am partner has the time of their life.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
It's very important. Not just have a good time, have a great time.
Yeah, so, exactly.
So, and I think that's what all of us do on the Legends Tour. And because we were raised to do that in the early days of the LPGA. I started playing in 74. Yeah. So, you know, it was important, you know, to make them feel so special.
Yeah. Right? Back then, Hollis, I remember playing with you guys when I first got on tour, and I was so nervous. Oh my gosh. I remember being on the range with you and Nancy Lopez, my very first tournament, and I was freaking out.
Where was that?
It was in North Carolina at High Point. And you came up to me and you're like, "Hi, what's your name?" And I was like, "Hi, I'm Shane." And you're like, "Hi, nice to meet you." And you just walked away. I was like, "Eh." What I was going to say was, you know, you guys were really, you were friends, but you guys were really competitive. Are we frozen here? Are we okay? Hold on.
Just a little bit.
There we go. Are we good? Okay, I think we're back. But what I was going to say was, you guys were like competitive. Like, I remember telling Sandra Palmer one time, I was taking a ball out of play my very first year, it was like my third tournament. And I was like, "I'm going to take my ball out of play." And she looked at me and she said, "Honey, you do whatever you want to do. You do not have to tell me." I was like, "Oh, okay, don't do that anymore." You know, but I remember playing with you sometimes and some stuff would happen. You guys were competitive back then, like with each other, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I think of the great competitions that I had, you know, with Amy Alcott and Lopez.
Yeah.
Oh, we just, I mean, you know, we took our wins personally and our losses personally.
Right.
You know, and Joanne Carter. Oh my God. Yes. Just
right.
We were very, very competitive and, you know, it was, you know, we wanted to win. So it didn't matter. I mean, now I call Amy up and yuck it up with her. But, you know, Pat Bradley. Oh,
yes.
So competitive.
Yes. Yes.
So competitive.
Yes. That era, you guys were in a really, you guys were in a unique little group, era that it was, and I don't know if it's because, like, you and Amy Alcott played junior golf together, correct? Didn't you compete against each other?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so there was this really inherent sort of friendship slash competitiveness with all of you guys that I just remember getting on tour and being, wow, like they are, Pat Bradley, you know, she was not going to be your friend when you were walking down the fairway.
No.
Right?
No.
Never.
No.
And if you talk to her about it now, she'll tell you the same thing. So Pat, if you hear that and you're watching, you know, you'd say the same thing, right? But, you know, I mean, it's, I mean, it was just, it was a little different. It was a little different. So I'm glad you acknowledge that, because I always felt like that was like, wow, these guys
it was serious.
Yeah,
it was serious. I remember Amy's toughest loss was, you know, my victory at Salem. And she double bogeyed the last hole. Oh God, I don't think we spoke for 2 years. It wasn't like, you know, it was just, it was such a tough loss for her.
Really? And,
you know, she doubled the last hole.
Was she winning? Was she leading?
Yeah, the witch was following her the whole time. Remember at Salem? So it was such a tough, I think, you know, it was just really tough. So.
Oh my gosh. But
she got even with me, so don't feel so too bad.
Oh yeah, I think Amy did just fine. Amy's actually, I'm talking to Amy next week. So I'll bring it up with Amy too. Yeah. I'll ask her about Salem. So what was your greatest win?
It was Salem.
Salem, really?
Yeah. I was never leading the tournament until the 72nd hole. So I hit the ball so well, and I had like nerve outs with my putting, because I hit probably 90% of all the greens, and I felt like I had to make everything, and I didn't really putt well till the last day, and so I just had to keep talking to myself, hang in there.
Was that your first U.S. Open win out of your
three? No, that was my third one.
That was your third. What were your other two?
The first one was Hazeltine in 77. Oh, nice. And 78 was Country Club of Indianapolis. So that's where I made a 4-footer on the last hole to beat Sally. So,
those are great golf courses. Those are good. Those are cool.
Yeah, Hazeltine was so hard. Oof. So hard. I didn't recognize it.
I know. You were up there. That's right. Last year. We were both there last year. It was hard and long. And the players, you know, the LPGA players that were playing it last year were just killing the ball on that golf course. It was really impressive to watch them play that course,
because it's
not an easy golf course. But that's awesome. Was there one, Hollis, along the way that there was one tournament that stands out that, you know, that said, oh, got away?
Yeah. The Anna.
Yeah.
I wanted to win that one. I finished second twice. And the last time I had a chance to win, Helen won. And before that, Sally shot 65 the last round, and I shot 72, I think. So she came.
But you won that 1 year.
I never won it. No.
Oh, I thought you won it.
No.
Oh, you won Du Maurier.
Yeah.
Right. That's your other major.
Yeah.
So what year, do you remember what year that was? What made it? What was the most, what happened? Did you hit a bad shot, or what happened?
No, I made the mistake of leading the tournament. So leading the tournament, you know, you know how it is, you know. You look at Betsy King's, you know, victories, like 90% of them were from behind, because, you know, she said, well, I got to rip it and shoot my 65 and while everyone else falls down while I was leading. And it's so hard, as you know, it's hard to hold that lead.
Yes.
So I think there's more pressure going in. If you're leading after three rounds, going into the final round, it's so much pressure. Yeah. To maintain that and control it's so much easier for someone
exhausting.
To come. Oh, yeah. So that was, you know, I guess I should have been two or three strokes behind. So,
next time. Hey, so you just had some shoulder surgery.
Yes.
Tell us about that a little bit, and how are you doing?
Well, my shoulder had been hurting me for 3 years, and finally, you know, I couldn't sleep, and you know, my swing had progressively gotten worse, and I thought it was because I'm not practicing as much. But my brother-in-law kept saying, "Hollis, put your right shoulder back." I said, I am. So finally, I went to a coastal orthopedic in Bradenton, where I live, and I knew that it was a torn rotator cuff. And so I was going to grill him, see what type of surgeon he was, because the good surgeons, they repair with a cut and then they sew it up, and then not arthroscopically. And so we took an x-ray, and there it was, bone on bone. So it wasn't a torn rotator cuff. So I had a total shoulder replacement.
Oh, wow. Basically,
because my rotator cuff was intact, I had a total. So it will get, I'll get full strength back. I won't get full flexibility, but I'll get full strength back. And I had a neat surgeon and young guy, Dr. Ott, and then they put in a new type of shoulder. It's called a stemless shoulder. So so it's called Simplicity. And I'm very happy. 5 months to the day, basically.
Wow, it's been that long already. Wow.
You played with me, remember?
I did right before.
Three wedge shots in a row. And I looked at you, I said, "Houston, we have a problem." So
Hollis, if you ask anybody about Hollis Stacy and her golf game, there's going to be one part of it that everybody through the years said, if you had to hit one person, had to hit a sand shot for you, it would be Hollis Stacy. So
thank you.
And I witnessed it a lot. Yeah. How did that come to be, Hollis? Because I can like visualize you hitting out of the sand. Is it just something that you just do, or
I had this great teacher. He was from Maine. He was an older, his name was Matt Warren. And he looked at me, and he had his Ben Hogan hat. He looked at me, he goes, "Never be afraid of the bunker." Really? And so I grew up on these Wilson sand wedges, which were the best. And so he would show me how to hit a bunker shot. And then I went to the Masters and I watched Julius Boros hit bunker shot. So I said, "Oh, I really like his swing." So I basically copied the way he hit his bunker shots. And, you know, so I was lucky. I was
brought
up not being afraid of bunker shot, because I had some great teachers. So,
yeah, but you just have you just get in the bunker and you look like you're going to hit a great shot. Some people get in the bunker and you kind of get a little paralysis by analysis, but anybody that wants to know anything about bunker shots, watch films of Hollis Stacy getting bunker shots, because it's, even with your shoulder bad, it was still pretty good.
I know.
It was.
I know. I remember I played an exhibition when I just won the Open, and I was really a hot shot. And I think it's Salem. I did an exhibition with Tiger. And Tiger was like, he was like eight years old. And I gave him a bunker lesson. I'm going to ask him about that. I said, I'm going to ask him how come he didn't mention it. But I gave him a bunker lesson.
Pretty well. I hope he gives you credit. It seems to be working pretty well.
Oh, so. Okay. No. He beat my ass. I want you to know that. He was eight. I shot 39, he shot 38.
Get out of here, seriously.
Oh, was it? Jan was supposed to play.
That's hysterical.
And I came home after that. That is hysterical. I laid down in my bed. I called my sister. I called my sister Martha after that. And I said, can you hear me? I called my sister Martha and I said, I just
You're frozen. Okay. There you are. Hold on. Hold on. There we are. We're back. Okay.
Okay.
I heard you. You said your sister Martha.
As I was laying down in bed, I called my sister up. I said, oh my God, I just got beaten by an 8-year-old boy. You know what my sister said? You better go practice. I just won the Open. Oh
God. I can hear Martha saying that actually.
Oh, you better go practice. You better go practice.
Martha, who was the low amateur, I think she was at Chicago, right? And Chicago. At Pine Needles, maybe. Both at the Senior Women's Open?
She was low amateur at the Senior Women's Open. She finished 10th.
Amazing.
I know.
She's always been a great player and one of the nicest people too. I love Martha.
She is.
She's one of the nicest people in golf. So a funny thing. So we have people that are watching now and commenting a little bit. And so I want to read you a message of someone you might know. Her name is Julie Brown.
She said,
I will never forget at a college event in Apopka, Florida, Hollis, by the way, Hollis went to Rollins College and played golf there. Hollis said, I'm out of here. No more Raleigh Collie going to the LPGA Tour.
Oh God.
That was her memory of
you. Hi, Julie. How are you? Yes. Oh, how young were we?
I know.
I wish I'd gone Rollins. 4 years. I wish I'd gone 4 years.
Rollins was you guys were, there were so many players back then that came through Rollins. You guys were a powerhouse then.
Great golfers. Great.
You and I are sorority sisters too, by the way.
Yes.
Kappa Gamma. Yeah. Hey, I have another question from a fan. They wanted to know what you thought of Chicago Golf Club when we played the Senior Women's Open there 2 years ago.
I loved Chicago Golf Club. It was extremely tough. It was suited to people that hit the ball high, and like Laura Davies, like Martha Leach, but even with my bad shoulder, I did finish 20 something or something like that. I finished in the middle of the field. So, but I love the golf course. Alistair, was it Alistair McKenzie?
I think it might have been. I've never played a golf course like that. I had never played a golf course where I felt like there was never a time where I could see the bottom of the pin. And it wasn't because everything was necessarily elevated. It was just the style of the course and the way it was built. It was so unique. I was really impressed. I thought it was a really, really cool golf course.
Really hard. Really.
Yeah.
I loved it.
The last couple, we played that and we played Pine Needles, and Pine Needles wasn't exactly easy either. I mean, everything that they had done to the golf course at Pine Needles and changed the green complexes and shaved the sides of the greens, and it was just crazy hard. So
extremely tough. The greens.
I know. It's not, you know.
They were tough.
Good. I mean, it's cool to play those courses, but hard when we don't play competitively as much as we do anymore, but it's always fun to play them, right?
But we do cram right before, don't we?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we do. We cram like there's no tomorrow.
I know. Someone asked me, how much do you play? Well, if there's a tournament, I'll play 30 days straight before the tournament, you know. Otherwise, you know. Yeah, because we still we have our egos. We don't want to make a complete fool of ourselves.
No. But the problem is, and I'm sure you feel the same, is that it's this, like what goes on in there and what I think should happen doesn't necessarily always come out of my hands and my body. That's a little bit of the problem.
I know.
Except for when I play with you. The last few times I played with you, I was playing out of my gourd. I don't even know what was, I wish it was a tournament. You and I played at Bradenton Country Club. I played like, I don't even know what happened that day. I played so well.
You know what happened? You had a new driver.
I did have a new driver. That's right.
You were killing it. In fact, I was holding that driver how many times? What is this shaft? Right? Remember?
Yes.
You were killing
it. I forgot about that.
You were killing.
I still have. that could have been almost the last time I played, Hollis. I haven't played in so long.
They did a nice job with the redo, didn't they?
Yes, it's beautiful. Anybody that's has an opportunity to play Bradenton Country Club, right?
Yeah.
Or golf club, Bradenton Country Club. It's beautiful.
It's a Donald Ross built 94 years ago. And we have a great membership. And Tony Jacklin was in charge of the redo. And he did phenomenal job.
Yeah, it's phenomenal. It's course, it was really fun to play. I had no idea, and I've lived in this area for quite a while and didn't even know about it. So it was a pleasant surprise to be able to go down there and play. Are you headed back to Florida? And when do you spend the summer typically in Colorado and then you go back down?
Yeah, we're usually here for 3 or 4 months, and God forbid, I hope I'm not there in August, for a storm, to pick up some things out of the house, I'll be back hopefully in September. That's my sketch.
Hollis, let's go back a little bit, because you were one of the players that started the Legends Tour. There were 24 players that put in money back in 2000, and well, it's 23 years, so however many that is, about.
It was in the late 90s,
2001, right? Late 90s. What was the thought process back then, Hollis, when you guys all got together and said, I kind of make up the story on my own, but I haven't ever asked anyone, what really was the thought process then? I just say, everybody just wanted to carry on for those behind them. But what really was the thought process?
Well, it was because there was no thought process of the LPGA doing anything, as far as a senior tour, because basically they were just, trying to make do and hang on with what they had.
Yeah.
And Ty Votaw was the commissioner then. So mm-hmm. We just decided we were going to do it. So that's what we did. And Jane took the reins, because I was still playing. And so Sally, myself, Jan Stevenson, and I, and Jane Blaylock were basically the starters of the senior tour.
Right.
And Jane took the reins because she had an office. And so
she
had left, and we were still playing. So, and I think that, it's morphed into more of a pro-am structure, which mm-hmm. I think is fabulous. Maybe have a few events. I'd like a few events, but pro-am structure, I think, is I think most of the players like that.
I think what's hard is now, having been obviously very close and trying to figure out how we create interest and create events and whatnot, it's hard because first of all, we're all very competitive and want to play well, but we don't have the opportunity to play in enough events to keep ourselves competitive. So I don't know about you, but we have to, when we play in these tournaments, keeping score for 4 days or 3 days when you haven't played a lot and under competitive conditions, it's hard. It's hard, and you want to play well. It's not hard to do. It's hard to accept that when you're not necessarily playing well and you have to post a score. So I think what you're getting at is kind of my thought process as well, is that hopefully we can get to the point where we do a really nice combination of events where they're team events or pro-ams and then we have the Senior Open and the Senior LPGA and other events where we do have to pull scores, but we have a nice combination where at least we're getting out there and playing. So that's the goal.
Right. I think it's all good. I think playing singularly, playing as a team, mm-hmm. and then playing in pro-ams to raise money for foundations and charities could be the future of the Legends Tour.
I agree. And we go back to what we were talking about before and the opportunity for our players to be great hosts and really, like you said, raise money and create great experiences for people to play in pro-ams and whatnot. That's really our bread and butter. And certainly our players are willing and able to do that. And so that's the goal. And it's unfortunate that this year we just got, with everything that happened with COVID, but you know, I'm looking forward to next year and hopefully being able to, you know, kind of get back on track and add, like you said, you and I have talked a lot about doing pro-ams and getting people interested in how do we raise money too? Because golf is such a great, you know, vehicle for that.
I know. Even though COVID's happening and everybody's stopped, I'm still working.
I know you still am working.
And I have a vision of what I want to do. And I think I might have my foot in some place. Interesting. Yeah. So
it's great, Hollis. You've been great. You know, and I brought that up because there were those 24 women that got together in the beginning and put up your own money. You put up your own money a long time ago to start this tour. And you're still involved, and people like you, and I know Jan, I talk to Jan often, you know, I talked to Don Capone yesterday, who are still, you know, are still wanting to help and still wanting to be a part of it. And I can't tell you how much I appreciate that. And everyone that plays the tour really appreciates that, because that's what it takes, you know?
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. It takes a village, even more so with us. So that's okay. It's what we know how to do, you know? I had a little message come across here that Marta Figueres-Dotti, who is in Spain right now, says hola to Hollis. Hi, Martita.
Hola, chiquitija. ¿Cómo estás? Muy bien. We miss you.
We do, Marta. I'm glad to hear that you're doing well. I watch on Facebook, and I'm glad you're watching today, but thanks for checking in.
Hola.
So Hollis, one kind of question that I've asked everybody is, if you had one golf course to play for, only one, for the rest of your life, what would that golf course be?
I loved Marion. Marion, so hard, so hard, so tight. The greens were like glass. I just loved it. You know, and it was so different from the course that I grew up on. And, you know, this course had bent greens. I thought it was just beautiful. I love Marion.
Did
you do that survey of courses for future U.S. Women's Open sites?
I did.
I said Marion.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
That would be a good one.
Yeah.
I've never played there. I've just watched on TV. So
it's hard. I love it.
You're the first person that said Marion. I love that.
What was your course?
Everyone's asked me and I don't have an answer, because now I keep listening to everybody and their reasoning, you know, behind the courses that they play, and everybody has some great answers. So now I'm like, I changed my mind. If I had ever played Augusta, which I haven't, I might say that, but I never, I got the opportunity to play a couple times and I turned it down back in the day, you know, thinking, I'll get invited again.
Uh-huh.
Way to go, Jane.
Well, so. Fred Ridley, he lives right there in Tampa.
He runs
the joint now. So.
All right. I'm going to give Fred a call and let him know that you said so.
Yes. Oh, I'm sure he'll drop everything.
Yeah, Fred's a great guy. He's a nice guy. Yes. So do you ever get back to Savannah and play golf, or what? Your mom's birthday was when? Just last week, right?
Mom's 29th birthday.
29th.
Was July 2nd, as well as my brother Tommy's. And she was great. She answered the phone. She goes, I'm 29 today. You know, she was 92. She's doing great. You know, she's doing really well. And she's been hunkered down with COVID. Yeah, she goes, she watches her mass every morning on the internet. So,
oh my gosh.
Yeah, she does. That's how she goes to church.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
I know. Sometimes I'll call her. She goes, you know, I'm in church now.
Oh my gosh. Oh, Hollis.
Okay. I forgot. She's doing well.
That's Tilly. Awesome.
She's doing it.
I'm a lot. Well, tell Tilly that I said hello. I mean, I just have such fond memories of her at the Open and stuff. And I'll just never forget the one time where she was sitting across that desk when I came in and I was in a rage coming in with my scorecard. I must have bogeyed or did something on the last hole. And I looked at her and she looked at me and I straightened right up. And I was like, you better behave. It was so funny.
Oh,
I'll never forget that.
Oh, yeah.
But please tell her I said hello. So, Paul, it was great talking to you today. This
is fun. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. And we'll play again when you come back. We'll go play Bradenton Country Club again when you come back down to Florida.
Yes, maybe you could bring your son.
Yes, Carson would love it. He'll caddy for me if not.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Well, thank you.
You're welcome. So anybody that's watching today, as I mentioned earlier, I just wanted to let everybody know that Amy Alcott's going to be with me next week, next Thursday at 4:00. I'm looking forward to that. And I'm going to ask her about that Salem Country Club thing. I'm probably going to bring up a bad note, but that's okay. It'll be fun. So,
yeah.
But thank you, Hollis. And take care. And I hope rehab continues to go well. Okay.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
All right. Stay safe.
Bye-bye.
Bye.